Good morning, grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Of course, it's in His name that we welcome you to worship this Sunday at First Presbyterian Church here in Dillon. We are thrilled that you are here, and we hope that you've come anticipating a work from the Lord. We know that as we commit our worship unto the Lord, as we worship the Lord in the splendor of holiness according to His Word, regulated by His Word, He has promised that He will not only be here with us, but that He would bless us. He promises that through His Word, He will conform us more into the image of Christ. Through His Spirit, He will be here with us, both as the Word is preached and as we gather around the Lord's table after our sermon, and that He will be here with us, especially now, so that we might enjoy His presence. Let me draw your attention to a few announcements on the back of your bulletin on page 8. If you have not turned in your baby bottles from our baby bottle campaign, well, we ask that you would do so as soon as possible so that we can send that money into those gifts into Lifeline Christian Services. And also, you have noted already, there is no children's church during the months of June and July. But if you have a young one who refuses to sit still or refuses to be quiet, please understand they don't bother me or Pastor Don or your neighbor. But if you feel like you need to go take them to the fellowship hall for a cry room area, feel free to do so. The service is streamed into that room along with the ladies' parlor. Also, Vacation Bible School starts this evening at 5:45. Supper will be served, and there'll be something for all ages. And so we hope that you'll come and be a part of this great annual event with us. And as you're coming, invite a friend or two so that we might enjoy fellowship, enjoy discipleship, so that we might grow in Christ together. That concludes our announcements for now. Please pay attention to the other announcements listed there, but let us prepare our hearts for worship. Our call to worship this morning comes from Isaiah chapter 12, verses 1 through 4, as the Lord invites us to praise Him, to come into His presence. If you'll please stand as you're able. The prophet says, "I will give thanks to you, O Lord, For though you were angry with me, in your salvation you have turned your anger away, that you might save me. Behold, God is my salvation. I will trust and I will not be afraid. For the Lord God is my strength and my song, and he has become my salvation. So with joy, give thanks to the Lord. Call upon his name. Make known his deeds among the peoples. Proclaim that his name is exalted. As we come to exalt the name of the Lord together, let us pray and then we'll sing. Father in heaven, we do come asking that you, by your Spirit, would enable us to worship you in the splendor of holiness and spirit and in truth, that you would be here with us, that you would make yourself real to us so that we might say as we leave this place that we have been in the presence of our Almighty God, that he has spoken to us by his word, and that he has changed us by his Spirit. And so, Father, we come asking that you would do a good work here amongst us, that you would save sinners, that you would draw us closer to yourself, that you would meet with us around your table so that we might have a foretaste of the heavenly city, the glories that are to come for all those who profess faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. So as we commit our worship unto you, as we sing and as we pray, as we listen and as we commune with thee, we pray, Lord, that you would continue to sanctify us and save us so that we might be living Ebenezers of your glory and grace to a lost and dying world. We pray these things in the name of Christ Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Well, as we now exalt the name of our Lord together in song, let us turn to 457. 457, let's sing that well-known hymn, Come Thou Fount of Every Blessing.
Please be seated. Well, as we continue in our worship service and come to a time of corporate together as a body, confessing our sin to the Lord, and that is printed on page 2 of your bulletin. Before we come to that time, let's take a brief moment on your own, just where you are quietly, to confess your own sins to the Lord, and then we'll come together and use this prayer printed on page 2 to confess our sins together. But again, let's take a moment to briefly go to the Lord, and then we'll come together. And now let us pray together using this prayer printed on page 2 of your bulletin. Let's pray. Have mercy on us, O God, according to your steadfast love, according to your abundant mercy, blot out our transgressions. Wash us thoroughly from our iniquities and cleanse us from our sins. For we know our transgression, and our sin is ever before us. Against you, you alone, have we sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless when you pass judgment. Indeed, we were born guilty, sinners when our mothers conceived us. Hide your face from our sins and blot out all our iniquities. Create in us clean hearts, O God, and put new and right spirits within us. Do not cast us away from your presence, and do not take your Holy Spirit from us. We pray through him who loved us and gave himself for us, our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Hear now from God's word in Micah chapter 7, verses 18 through 20, about the compassion and grace of our God, as God's word reads, "Who is a God like you, pardoning iniquity and passing over transgression for the remnant of his inheritance? He does not retain his anger forever, because he delights in steadfast love. He will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. You will cast all our sins into the depths of the sea. You will show faithfulness to Jacob and steadfast love to Abraham, as you have sworn to our fathers from the days of old." Amen to the reading of God's word. You know, Christians, we of all people should be those who are humble, because we should be able to admit, not with pride, not with boasting, but that we really are sinners who deserve condemnation. We have especially sinned against God, and yet we can walk in the freedom of knowing that there is forgiveness with God. We do not need to make it up. We can't make it up, but God has made it up for us in giving his Son for us, that we can walk in forgiveness before God, knowing that we are accepted because of Christ. Well, as we now continue from our confession of sin, let us worship God by the giving of our tithes and offerings. Let us remember to, as we're in the midst of the summer, as it begins to heat up again, this morning looks good, but generally summers are a very difficult time in churches, and as people go out of town. I wasn't here last week, and but let us be mindful to continue to be faithful in our giving. And again, it's a way that we worship God. Deacons, if you would come forward, and we'll worship God now in this manner.
Thank you. God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, Lord, you are good always. You are totally independent of us, Lord, and we are totally dependent on you for our hearts beating right now, for our molecules holding together. Your word says that Jesus upholds all things by the word of his power. So, Father, we recognize our dependence on you. We recognize that everything, life and breath and Lord, even the ability to earn a living and to be able to give is from you. So we thank you for that grace. We thank you for these tithes and offerings that have been given. And again, we pray that they would be used for your glory and honor alone. Would you set them apart for that? We ask in Christ's name. Amen. Well, if you would, in your bulletin, as we get ready to hear God's word, we'll sing a song. That is in your printed in your bulletin on page 4. O church, arise, as we are not yet the church triumphant. The church triumphant are those who have passed on to glory, are with Jesus right now. But those of us who are still here and on this earth, we are called the church militant. And the Bible likens us to being a military force, one that goes out and spreads the good news of the reigning King, Christ Jesus, and the salvation that is found in him, and also going forth and exposing the works of darkness and the crown rights of King Jesus. But let us sing this song together again on page 4, O Church, Arise.
Thank you.
seated. As we prepare our hearts for the time of hearing God speak through the reading and preaching of His Word, if you open your Bibles to Psalm 119, in your pew Bible, that's going to be on page 650, and as you turn there, the choir will join the congregation. Well, for the past handful of years, during the summer months, we have been breaking to study together selected psalms throughout our Psalter. And this summer, we are doing nothing different. We are breaking to study the psalms together, but there is one glaring difference than previous summers. This summer, we'll be looking at a singular psalm, Psalm 119, where the psalmist David exhaustively celebrates and rejoices the law of God as contained in our Bibles. One of the things that we must know about Psalm 119 is not only is it a lengthy psalm, but it's the longest song that is within our scriptures. It's the longest chapter within all of our Bibles. And repeatedly, stanza after stanza after stanza, David will celebrate the beauty and the glory of the Word of God. He says that it is better to him than all of the riches that this world has to offer. It's sweeter to him than the honey of the honeycomb. That this is the special revelation of God, and we ought to pay careful attention to it because it will teach us a lot about daily Christian living. Now, if you don't understand what I mean, if that concept, that language, special revelation of God is foreign to you, let me briefly explain what I mean. The Bible tells us that we can know that there is a God simply by looking at nature. That the Lord has revealed Himself through His creation. He tells us throughout the Scriptures that as we see the beauty of the sunrise and the sunset, as we see the glories of the beasts of the earth and the fish of the sea, as we watch the rainfall, as we hear the birds sing, there is never a doubt in our minds that there is a sovereign God who has created all of these things. He says it is so knowledgeable. Creation is so knowledgeable, so forthcoming in its declaration that there is a creator. In Romans chapter 1, Paul says that not one of us has an excuse not to believe in God. That He reveals Himself to us in creation. But also He especially reveals Himself to us in our Bibles. The Bible teaches us so much more about God, about who He is, what He has done, what He is going to do. Our Bibles tell us in which ways we might have a right standing with God through faith in Jesus Christ, and it actually teaches us how we can live for His glory. And so creation reveals to us very naturally the existence of God, but especially our Bibles tell us, reveals to us who our God is. And David celebrates this throughout Psalm 119. In Psalm 19, he celebrates natural revelation. He says, "The heavens declare the glory of God, and the sky above proclaims His handiwork." In Psalm 104, he says, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, O Lord my God. You are very great, for you have stretched out the heavens like a tent, and you lay the beams of your chambers on the waters. You set the foundations of the earth so that the earth shall never be moved. You've covered the earth with a deep garment, the waters that stood above the mountains." Even David says that we should rejoice and praise God for what He has done in creation. But here in Psalm 119, he turns his attention specifically to the special revelation of God. He says that it's in our Bibles that we learn what we need to know about our God, how He has saved us through Christ, how we are to enjoy Him and live for His honor and glory forever. And it's exhaustive. I think I've said that already, but I need to underline that. It's exhaustive the way that David writes here. He actually uses, if you'll just look at your Bibles, he actually uses every letter of the Hebrew alphabet: Aleph, Beit, Gimel, Dalet, He, and so on. And for each letter of the Hebrew alphabet, he'll write eight verses. He'll write eight verses for every letter of the Hebrew alphabet. And it just seems as if his heart is overflowing with love and adoration and praise to God for giving us His Word. He'll tell us the advantages of God's Word. He'll tell us the excellencies of God's Word. He'll tell us the necessity of God's Word. He'll say that it's a lamp unto our feet, a light unto our path. And sometimes the stanzas will correlate. They'll seem to have a running theme, and sometimes it'll be stream of consciousness. It will be as if David is just writing and writing and writing, and yet what Matthew Henry, the famous commentator of the Scriptures, says is this psalm is not meant to be a chain of golden links. It's simply supposed to be a chest of fine gold. And it's this fine gold in which David invites us to plunder as we start this journey this morning in Psalm 119. Invites you to plunder the riches of God's Word so that we might take it and make application for ourselves, so that we might treasure it, and even as our sermon title this morning says, that we might guard our hearts with this Word. And so I want to read verses 1 through 16, the first two stanzas of this song. And so hear God's Word now, people of God. "Blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep His testimonies, who seek Him with their whole heart, who also do no wrong but walk in His ways. You have commanded Your precepts to be kept diligently. Oh, that my ways may be steadfast in keeping Your statutes. Then I shall not be put to shame. Having my eyes fixed on all of Your commandments, I will praise You with an upright heart when I learn Your righteous rules. I will keep Your statutes. Do not utterly forsake me. How can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to Your word. With my whole heart I seek You. Let me not wander from Your commandments. I have stored up Your word in my heart that I might not sin against You. Blessed are You, O Lord. Teach me Your statutes. With my lips I declare all the rules of Your mouth. In the way of Your testimonies I delight. As much as in all riches, I will meditate on Your precepts and fix my eyes upon Your ways. I will delight in Your statutes. I will not forget Your word." The grass withers, the flower fades, but the word of our God remains forever and ever. Let me pray for us. Father in heaven, this is Your word, and this is how You especially reveal Yourself to us. And so, Father, let us see You clearly. Let us see ourselves clearly. Let us be reminded of the gospel clearly, that we need Your presence. We need Your Spirit to fill us so that we might make application to this Your word. Would You teach us, Lord, how to glorify Your name? Would You teach us how to guard our heart against the temptation of the flesh and the temptation of the evil one? And would we be found faithful servants of Thee on the last day. Father, we pray these things in Your Son's name. As You speak to us, speak loudly, we ask. Amen. Well, this past week I was listening to Dr. Doug Kelly's opening sermon to his series on Psalm 119 that he preached many years ago at Reedy Creek Presbyterian Church. And in that sermon, he spoke of how shocking it might be for us to consider the exhaustiveness of the psalmist David here in Psalm 119. Remember, he uses every letter of the Hebrew alphabet, and for each letter he writes 8 verses recognizing or distinguishing for us each stanza of this song. And Dr. Kelly said that this might come across as quote-unquote too much, that it might seem quote-unquote over the top. And if it doesn't seem that way to you, surely it comes across at least tedious. And Dr. Kelly says that is the natural response when we begin to look at how David profusely pours out his heart here in his love for the Word of God until we catch the same love in which David has. He says, when we recognize or when we realize how overflowing with adoration that we should be for the Word, it will seem over the top. It will seem too much. It will seem tedious what David tries to do here or even accomplishes here within this selected psalm. You know, as I was listening to that, I was reminded of this social media craze from a few years ago that I saw repeatedly happening around Valentine's Day. It was a unique gifts that Valentines would give to one another, and it would be a full deck of playing cards, 52 cards, and as the Valentine would open the box of the card, they would begin to flip through, you know, the diamonds and the hearts, then the puppy toes or the clubs or the spades, and with each card that they saw, there would be a trait, a characteristic, in which their Valentine loved about the other. And at first, my response to that was, especially as a guy, because we're not that creative, that's kind of ridiculous. Why would anybody spend that much time pouring out their hearts, talking about all these traits for their loved one? It's always tedious until you realize how much you love your Valentine, right? Then it seems as if I could do 2 decks of cards or 3 decks of cards. It comes so easily when we really feel the love and the adoration and the admiration for our spouse or our Valentine. And that's something like what's before us here. There's a real treasuring of the Word from the psalmist David. David will even say later on, it'll take us a number of weeks to get here, but in verse 72, he will say that the Word of God, the law of God, the law of God's mouth is better to me than thousands of gold and silver pieces. David understands, and he cannot exude it enough that there is a love, a treasuring to the Word of God that each and every believer ought to have. And so it seems as if David begins writing under the inspiration of the Spirit, and it seems as if his love just continues to outpour, overflow from his heart. We heard about in Sunday school, we have just started in mine and Lee's class, the study of Philippians. And Sinclair Ferguson, who wrote the little study book that we're using, says that joy ought to flow out of each other's heart like a water flows downstream. That it seems natural, it seems quick, it seems never ending. And that's exactly the admiration, the joy in which the law of God, the Word of God brings to the psalmist David here. And so David desires for us to learn something about the law of God, the very Word of God. As New Testament Christians who have a complete Bible, he desires for us to have an affection, a treasuring to our Bibles as Christians. And David begins with the first Hebrew alphabet letter, Aleph. If you'll just look back at verses 1 and 2, we'll handle this first stanza. It says, "Blessed are those whose way is blameless, who walk in the law of the Lord. Blessed are those who keep His testimonies, who seek Him with their whole heart." It's interesting to me here that as David begins this psalm, as he begins to write this song before us, he begins to use what we would understand as New Testament Christians, these Beatitudes. We know something about Beatitudes, don't we? In Matthew chapter 5, Jesus tells us that it is blessed. There are blessed people. In those Beatitudes, he says, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." And you learn something about this beatitude. There's always this adjective, blessed or blessed. And then there's always an identification of who is blessed. And then there's always a condition assuring you of blessedness. And so here in our text, the blessed one is the one who walks in the law of the Lord. His way is blameless. Those who seek the Lord with all of their heart, they will be blessed. And the way that they'll be blessed is that they will be seen as righteous. David is very quick to say that if we will live according to the law of God, if we will live according to our Bibles, the way that our Bibles teach us to live, teach us to walk, there will be a real righteousness to be had. So here in our text, the blessed one is the one who walks in the law of the Lord. Essentially what David is saying here is that the blessed one is the one who hears the Word of God and also does the Word of God, who hears it and obeys it. The one who walks according to the law of God, the one who walks in the way, as our text says. The one who walks in the way is a man, a woman, a Christian who is directed by God's Word. Of course, our God has described for us, hasn't He, how a Christian ought to live. You think about Micah chapter 6, verse 8. Where the prophet tells us, "He has told you, O man, what is good and what the Lord requires of you, to do justice, to love kindness, and to walk humbly with your God." In Mark chapter 12, Jesus says, "And you shall love the Lord your God with all of your heart and with all of your soul and with all of your mind and with all of your strength. And you shall love your neighbor as yourself. There is no other commandments greater than these." And so if we are to walk in a way that is blameless, we need to understand that the psalmist is telling us that we are to walk according to the Word of God. That we must hear it, that we must obey it. For that's how we surely know that we have really heard it. And so here it is that the Lord tells us that as we walk in the ways of the Lord, we will be blessed. And I think that's remarkable. I think that's remarkable. Not only would our God call us to live in a certain way, not only would He call us to live in a certain way, which is His right because He is our Creator, but He promises that if we will do it, He will bless us. You know, oftentimes when Brooks and Anna Kate begin to ask me why I tell them to do something, why do I have to clean my room? Why do I have to pick up my toys? Why do I have to eat my vegetables? Usually my response, and I hate this response, is because I'm your daddy and I told you so. You know, the Lord would have every right to tell us that. The Lord would have every right to say, it's because I'm your Creator and I told you to do it. But that's not what He does, is it? He actually tells us there is a blessing to be had that if we would simply obey our Creator, if we would simply live for our Savior. You know, oftentimes we want our lives to have some sort of fulfillment and meaning. We want our lives to count for something. We want to seem like our life has a real value. We want relationships to satisfy us. And those are good things. But what the psalmist is declaring here in this first stanza of this song is that that will never happen apart from a real relationship with Jesus that not only hears the word but also obeys the word. You will not have a life of blessedness if you cannot live according to the ways of the Lord, that if you cannot walk in the law of the Lord. In a culture that tells us that real satisfaction and fulfillment can be found within ourselves, the psalmist declares something so countercultural, doesn't he? Only under the law of God can we find what we are looking for. You will not find meaning and fulfillment as you chase the American dream. You will not find fulfillment in prestigious job titles. You will not find fulfillment in identifying yourself in an ever fleeting and ever changing ideology. You will not find fulfillment or gratification in any sort of human relationship if you do not have a right relationship with Christ. If you do not walk in the law of the Lord, if you do not walk in a way that is blameless, if you do not keep His testimonies, if you do not seek Him with your whole heart. That is the way to blessing. That is a way to blessedness. And David, understanding this, if you look at the end of that stanza in verse 8, he says, then it's almost like a vow or a covenant with God. I will keep your statutes. I will keep them. The psalmist makes this pact, this covenant with the Lord. He declares, I will do it. He knows that the ways that his life would be steadfast is simply by obeying the law of God. He knows that the way that we are not to be put to shame is to have our eyes fixed upon the commandments. He knows the way that real learning takes place is knowing the righteous rules of God. And so he says, you know what? I will do it. And yet at the very same time, he pleads for God's mercy. Do not utterly forsake me. Here it is that we see David making a vow, but at the same time knowing in and of himself that he is not able to keep this vow. He is not able to withstand the temptation of his flesh. He is not able to stand against the snares of the evil one. And so he pleads for mercy. Do not forsake me. And so as a people of God, do we understand that we are to live for God's glory? As Christians, do we understand that we have vowed to live according to God's commandments? If you're a member of this church, do you understand that you have taken a vow between God and one another that you will pursue righteousness and Christ's likeness? And so we are to do the very same thing that David did. I will do it. I will do it. I will set my attention upon living a life that is glorifying to the Lord. And at the same time, I will pray, never leave me to my own strength, Lord, nor to my own heart, because I need your presence to fulfill the vow that I have taken. We must be active in our pursuit to walk very diligently here with Jesus. We must be about the business of living a life of holiness, keeping the Lord's commandments, observing all that He has taught us, and at the same time we must pray that God would enable us to do so. And then as we move into that second stanza, verses 9 through 16, we see the determination of the psalmist. If you look at verse 9, how can a young man keep his way pure? By guarding it according to your word. Then look at verse 11. I have stored up your word in my heart that I might not sin against you. How is David determined to walk in a way that is blameless? How is he determined to walk according to the law of the Lord? He says, I will hide your word in my heart. Now, I think this is the greatest proof text that we have for the spiritual discipline of memorizing Scripture. But before we can even go there, there's something that needs to be noted. Because David writes here in a way that he's saying that I need to always have God's word in my heart. I need an ongoing faithfulness. It's an ongoing action of hiding God's word in my heart. I have to be constantly determined to plunder the riches of God's word. He's challenging the reader. I hope you see this. He's challenging the reader here to understand that we must be in our Bibles day by day. Why? Verse 10. With my whole heart I seek you. Let me not wander from your commandments. He knows that he is prone to wander. As we sung together in our opening hymn, prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. That's David in verse 10. He's saying, listen to this. He says, the more I know the Word of God, the more I understand my own proneness to wander away from God. Isaiah chapter 53 declares that we, like sheep, have gone astray. We have gone our own way. And there's something to be learned by that very phrase. Because like sheep, we see out of the corners of our eyes. Yes, we have our eyes fixed upon Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep. But then in the corner of our eyes, we see these temptations, these idols. And we'll say, you know what, I'll just wander over here for a second. And then out of the corner of our eye, we see something else. And we'll say, well, I'll just wander a little bit farther away. And then all of a sudden, we look up and where's the shepherd? You know, a sheep has no intention to being lost. He's just looking for something that satisfies him. And so he eats from this little patch of grass here, and then he wanders over there and he eats from that patch of grass, and then he sees that little patch of grass and he goes over there, and then he moves over there because he's seen that little patch of grass, and all of a sudden he looks up and there's no more sheep to be found and no shepherd to be seen. And he needs the great shepherd of the sheep to come rescue him. That is you, beloved. That's you. Our hearts tend towards this idol over here or this sin over there, and it brings instant gratification, but soon that gratification wears off and we see out of the corner of our eyes another and another and another, and soon our sin has led us astray and we have no hope in saving ourselves because the great shepherd of the sheep is nowhere to be found. David understands this is the tendency of his heart. He knows the readiness of his foolish heart to wander away from the Lord. So he says, the way that I guard against that is I must store up your word in my heart so that I might not be distracted by these temptations, that I might not be distracted by these sins, so that I can withstand the snares of the devil, so that I can conquer the sins of the flesh. And here's the practical ways that we must do it. It could all be summarized in we must be students of the Word. But how are we to be students of the Word? Very quickly, we must be committed to personal Bible reading. We must be committed to personal Bible reading. We cannot know God without knowing the whole Bible. Our Bible, from Genesis to Revelation, tells us about God. It's a grace-filled means to know God through His Word, to spend time with Him, to hear from Him, to pursue Him as He reveals Himself in the Scriptures. God has breathed out this Word. He reveals Himself and His Christ, our Savior, to us. And we must be about reading the whole counsel of God's Word, because when we do it, we receive the gift of hearing from our God. And He makes His Word effectual to our salvation. He renews our minds, conforms us into His likeness and image. He points out our sin and guides us to His grace. So we need to read the Word personally, but we also need to sit under the Word. What do we learn when we sit under the Word preached? Well, we train ourselves to ask the right questions, don't we? Sometimes we understand that context matters when we're reading the Word. What does this chapter say? What does this book say? That there's different genres of the Bible, narrative, songs like we have here, apocalyptic language like we have in Revelation that seems so confusing. When we sit under the Word preached, we begin to help ourselves, to teach ourselves through the guidance of the Scripture that here is Christ, that's my main focus, and how does this apply to my life? How does this apply to my obedience? How does this apply to my daily living? And so it helps us not only study the Word better, but to interpret it well and faithfully and to apply it. But thirdly, we need to be about Bible memorization. Because here it is, so clearly before us, isn't it? That sin lures us into sinful action. And how can we withstand the temptation? Well, beloved, we look no further than the example of Christ there in the wilderness. Each and every time Satan approaches Christ with a temptation, Jesus rebukes him using the very words of God. And he knows the words of God, so he knows the promises of God. And so he understands that what Satan is tempting him with, God has offered him something better in his word. And so our assurance of salvation against temptation, when we seem to be in the spiritual wilderness, Bible memorization will help us keep our gaze upon the promises of God steadier and clearer. And that is how David says he treasures the law of God, the Word of God, his Bible. That's how he says that he guards his heart in this sin-filled world, that he guards it with the Word of God as he reads it, as he hears it, and as he memorizes it. So that when temptation comes, he can cling to the commandments, the statutes, the laws of God, where he can find joy, freedom, fulfillment, satisfaction, a life of blessing. Beloved, do you want a life of blessing? Here's where you find it. You find it here in the Word of God, and you keep it. You obey it, for that is how our Lord has taught us that we will be blessed. Let me pray as the elders come. Father in heaven, we do thank you for the opportunity to come to this your Word. And Father, we know our shortcomings. And so as we hear this exhortation that we must hear the Word and keep the Word of God so that we might have a life of blessing. We know, Lord, that in and of ourselves, we are so unable to do that. So we plead the mercies of Christ. The same mercies of Christ who caused Him to take on flesh, to dwell amongst us, to live a life of perfect obedience. Where we fail the law, Christ succeeds so that we might be the full righteousness of God. He laid down His life, body broken, blood shed for us. Father, as we gather around this table, let that sacrifice be remembered. But also, Lord, let us have a foretaste of heaven that is to come, where we get to feast with Jesus for all eternity. We pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. Well, our Lord Jesus Himself invites us to this table. He invites us with the words, "Come, taste and see that the Lord is good, and that His faithfulness is steadfast from generation to generation." This is not the table of First Presbyterian Church, nor is this the table of our denomination, the Presbyterian Church in America. This is the Lord's table. And so if you can come clinging to Christ and Him crucified, if you can come pleading the mercies of Christ in your place, if you can come saying that Jesus, the Savior, is mine and I am His, this table is open to you. You are to take the bread, you are to take the cup, and you are to remember and proclaim the Lord's death until he comes again. But there is a fence around this table, a spiritual fence, that says that if you do not know Christ, if he is not your Lord and Savior, if you have not called upon him and submitted your life to him as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords over your life, you are not to partake. Paul tells us in his letter to the Corinthian church that if we would eat and drink of this meal in an unworthy manner, we are eating and drinking further judgment, further damnation upon our own souls. And so if you do not know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, we ask that you would let these elements pass you by, but that you would use this time to call upon Christ. He is faithful to forgive you. He is faithful to cleanse you. He will allow, enable Christ's blood that was shed on the cross of Calvary to wash you as white as snow. He will clothe you in the righteousness of Christ if you will call upon his name. Also, if you have sin in your heart, if you are bitter towards a brother or sister in Christ, if you're holding a grudge, we ask that you would let these elements pass you by. If there's sin within your life that you cannot shake, a besetting sin that you are not repentant of, we ask that you would let these elements pass you by, but that you would use this time to reconcile yourself with Christ, knowing that he will forgive you of all sin. There is not one sin. There's not one sin that he will not forgive you from. As the great hymn says, "My sin, oh, the bliss of this wondrous thought, my sin, not in part, but the whole, was nailed to the cross, and I bear it no more. Praise the Lord, oh, my soul." The Lord has nailed upon the cross of Calvary all of your sin as you come confessing it. So we ask that you would let these elements pass you by this time, but that you would confess those sins that have a grip upon your heart, and that you would plea with Christ for mercy, knowing that he is merciful and long-suffering. But if you can come saying, "I come only being made worthy through Jesus. I come washed in his blood, clothed in his righteousness," and you come. You come taste and see. You come eat. You come drink. This meal was prepared for you. On the night that our Lord was betrayed, as he gathered in the upper room with his disciples, he gave thanks and he took the bread and he broke it. And he said, "This is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." It's our practice here at First Presbyterian Church to hold the elements until all have received, and then we'll partake together. body of Christ broken for you. Take and eat, all of you. In the same way, Jesus took the cup. And after dinner, he passed it to his disciples and he said, "This cup is a symbol of a representation of the outpouring of my blood, which will be shed for many for the remission of sins. As often as you eat, also drink." Again, let us hold the elements until all have received, and then we'll partake together. Blood of Jesus, which takes away the sins of all who believe, take and drink. Let me pray again. Father in heaven, we thank you for this simple meal that reminds us of the person and work of Jesus Christ, that the perfect, spotless Lamb of God would bleed and die so that we might be called the sons and daughters of righteousness. Father, we pray that you would cause this remembrance to be a spiritual awakening for each and every one of us, that the gospel would be more clear now than ever before, and that we would cling to you for mercy and for grace, knowing, Lord, that there is not one sin that can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. For you have loved us so much that you sent your only begotten Son so that he might be a ransom for many. Father, we pray that that gospel message would be our own and that it would cause us to long for heaven where the gospel is perfectly before us, the Lamb who was slain, feasting with us at the marriage supper of the Lamb, where we worship him forever and ever for what he has done for our sake. We pray these things in your Son's name. Amen. Well, it's proper for us to respond to God's word and the sacrament with singing. And so if you will take out your hymn books one more time and turn to 247, we'll sing, O Sacred Head Now Wounded, all three verses. Let's stand and sing aloud as you are able. Let me remind you that tonight does start Vacation Bible School. Dinner will be served at 5:45. We hope to see you and many visitors later on this evening. We'll sing the Gloria Patri right after the benediction, and now receive the blessings of the Lord from the word of the Lord. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all now and forevermore. Amen.